Mr.
Good morning.
Happy free New Year's Day coming up in a couple days. Hope you guys have your holiday and New Year resolutions you're thinking about. If we can all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. Oh, sorry about that. I would like you all to make sure you've turned off your cell phones. And the mission, Morning Rich, the mission of Toastmasters is that we provide a supportive and a positive learning experience in which members are empowered to develop communication and leadership skills, resulting in a greater self-confidence and personal growth. That's what we do. And here to get us started as our Toastmaster of the day, please welcome Mr. Gus Tady.
Gus Tady.
Good morning, fellow Toastmasters, and no guests yet. Before we wrap up the year, I wonder what most of you did the day after Christmas. Hangovers? Sleeping? Opening gifts? The day after Christmas is what I have chosen as the theme for today, which is called Boxing Day. It has no gloves, I hear, so it has nothing to do with boxing. I will tell you a little bit about that, but it's more of a United Kingdom thing. It's the British who started that many, many years ago, the day after Christmas, and they talked about Boxing Day. I'll tell you more about that later on. Let me go on to the technical table. Before the technical table, there are some adjustments in our agenda. Our counter is going to be Mr. Mike Hughes.
Oh, good.
Thank you, Mike. Our grammarian is Julia, and the word is posted somewhere around. She will tell us about that shortly. And our timer is Carmen Lopez. Thank you for filling in on that schedule.
You're still an evaluator.
You're right. Rich Master is here. We need an evaluator. Crystal, she will be here. She's going to, Stephen has the manual for Rich, and Stephanie has the manual for Alexander. It is a pretty tight schedule because I'm learning the lesson. Right, Crystal. You're participating. You have a role, you play Martin, but you can evaluate.
I'm in. I don't know.
Never get around you. He's doing his third
speech. I'm doing something with Alexander, okay. Or somebody else would like to.
You know what?
No, you're up on front. You're on the front end.
Okay.
Yes, you're on the front end.
Should you step up?
You better step up.
So all of our roles are completed, your manuals, and also if you came in with your competent leader and you're going to be performing a role, it looks like everybody has a role today.
Yeah.
Make sure you pass on your competent leader for someone who may be able to help you. I'm going to move on directly to our technical table to tell us what they have to do. So we'll start with our grammarian. And our grammarian will tell us our role today. Julia Kaufman, please come forward.
My role as grammarian is to provide the word of the day, which is zinger. It's a quick or witty or pointed remark or report. You can also, in boxing, do a zinger, surprising your opponent. The other function of my role is to listen to vocabularies and language and to provide feedback as to what I like and any corrections in grammar. That's my role, and I'll report at the end. Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster.
Thank you. And next to the grammarian, we need to be able to watch some of our tongue clicks, so I will now introduce our counter, which I love his role, Mike Hughes.
As the honor counter, my function listen for the filler words such as all you know, so okay, and other audible pauses as fillers. I will be noting if members perform any double clutches, this means, which is to say things twice, such as this means. Finally, I will also include things that might be distracting, such as lip smacks. I'll present my report at the end of the meeting. Thank you, sir.
The mayor, our counselor, and the zinger actually going to be our timer, Carmen Lopez.
My function is to time the speakers, evaluators, and table talk participants to ensure they meet the timing requirements. I will demonstrate the timing lights, which will be displayed as follows. Speakers, green is 5 minutes, yellow is 6 minutes, red is 7 minutes. Table topics, green is 30 seconds, yellow is 45 seconds, and then red is 1 minute. For evaluators, green is 2 minutes, yellow is 2.5 minutes, and red is 3 minutes. At the end, I will report the timing results.
Thank you, all right. There'll be a different timing when Alexander Dawes has speech. She's going to give a 4 to 5 minute speech that will be followed by
45.
Oh, 40, yeah, 4 to 5. Thank you. And that will be followed by group discussion and question and answer time. Boxing Day, it's really like Black Friday after Thanksgiving. It's what the British would do in order for them to be able to go out and shop. But it was also a time where people would give out gifts. And so the idea had nothing to do with boxing, but boxes after Christmas gifts where they'll be putting articles and be able to share with people. We're going to start off with our speakers, prepare speeches for today. The first speaker is James Harris, and his speech is Attitude, More Important Than Facts. James believes that attitude is more important than facts, and he wants to share this. I'm speaking from the Competent Communicator Manual, project number 3, Get to the Point. Please help in welcoming James Harris. James.
I cried the blues because I had no shoes. Until one day upon the street, I met a man who had no feet. Don't cry the blues. Be positive. We're going to talk about the right attitude. The attitude of work, hard work. Attitude of having no fear. And having a positive attitude is all necessary. Work. My best example of work is when I was in junior high school, I was a wrestler. Never told you this before. I lost my first 10 matches. I even lost to a blind kid. I wanted to quit. It was time to give up. But I realized that now I had to do some hard work. I needed to train harder. I needed to learn the skills. I needed to have stamina. And my whole attitude just changed. I'm gonna be me. Have no fear. Slap my opponent. No, don't do that. But long story short, a year later, as a junior, undefeated. As a senior, team co-captain. I won 42 matches out of 43. We were New York State champions, Mount Vernon High School, 1966 and 67. We were the best out of 484 schools. And we all had the same attitude. It was all about attitude. Not how much muscle you had, a little muscle count, but it was attitude. You must have a good attitude and no fear. Well, not really no fear. You have to understand fear and know how to use it. You have to make fear your friend, your buddy, deal with him. Because he's always there. Reminds me of why I joined Toastmasters. I was at this awards banquet. I had coached a team there locally, Meadowbrook Junior High up in Pine Hills. And they were a school that was on the bottom run. The first year, They took second in the cabin. We had this great big banquet. All these people were there, and wrestlers were there, and their parents were there. They invited me up to receive this nice, beautiful award. And I looked out in a sea of eyes looking at me. It was like, oh my God. My knees is like, buckle. I could not say a word. I just froze. I went stiff. I said, thank you, and just went and sat down. Like I was afraid of everybody. It was the attitude of fear. It just grasped me by the throat. But you need to grab fear by the throat. Shake him up and throw him down. Yeah, Pickles, okay. You can hang with me. But understand fear. Fear happens. So, fear and attitude. Two things. Control your fear, have the right attitude. I can remember in all of my wrestling matches, I was always afraid and always wanted to quit. I got on the mat and I would say, I'm out here again. Why are you here? Just thinking that, oh, do you really want to do this? And all of a sudden, the ref would have us shake hands, and then the whole thing just changed. It was like a light came on. It was like, ah! You are Miss Me, and I am a tiger. Bring it on! It was Toastmasters. Every Toastmaster speech, even to this day, there's some anticipation, there's some fear, there's some concern, there's a few butterflies. But you combat that through attitude, and you must prepare. There must be some preparation, whether it's 5 minutes long, or an hour long, or 3 days long. I mean, the better you get, the shorter it is. But there must be some preparation. And when you see fear, you say, come on, buddy, let's go. Come on. You have to understand that fear is part of the process. The attitude is, I'm better than you. I can deal with you. Attitude is more important than all the facts. The fact that you may be, you know, from the east side of town, from South America, from wherever. Your color may be whatever. Has nothing to do with the fact that I got the right attitude. And if you come into my circle, we're gonna have to deal. That's why Toastmasters is so great. Because in Toastmasters, you're gonna discover with PMA, with positive mental attitude, you will meet the most important person in the world. As long as you stay positive and continue to improve. You're gonna look in the mirror, you're gonna see you. That's the most important person in the world. That's the attitude of a winner and a person that stays and takes all the feedback and gets better and better and better. Attitude is more important than facts.
Yeah. Timer 1 minute on the clock. Please fill out your evaluations. 1 minute on the clock.
Seriously.
Our next speaker is speaking from the Entertaining Speaker Manual, Project Number One. To entertain the audience by relating a personal experience, how you organize the speech and for maximum impact. The byline to the speech is it wrong to take revenge on a blind man? How else will they see the error of their ways? The title of the speech is Revenge. This best served heart. Please help me welcome Conqueror Communicator Rich Master.
Boy, do I have a zinger of a story for you today. When I grew up in New Jersey, I was very close with my cousin Damon. My cousin Damon, you've heard me tell stories with my cousin Damon before. He is likely the most intelligent, talented guy in our family. That's coming from me. He can play the keyboard. He's a genius with computers. He's actually in a band called Illegally Blind. So you see, he's not the only one with a sense of humor in our family. I think the reason why we were very close is because I didn't treat him any different than anyone else, our family, our friends, or any other person. And if you know me, I love a good prank. I can tell you about the time I tricked him to go on a roller coaster. Have you ever seen a blind man on a roller coaster? It's hilarious. Do you want to know why? They can't anticipate the turns. He was whipping up, down, side to side. It was hilarious. I'm going to claim that again. I can tell you the time we had a great memory where I ran out of gas on the highway, and being the genius that I am, I hitchhiked to go get gas and left my poor blind cousin in the car. And a cop car came behind him and decided to push my car with him in it off the highway. Try to soak that in for a second. Having the close relationship that we had, Damon decided one day to embarrass me in front of a girl I liked. And being Italian, that is not a good idea, because I must now have my revenge. So I used to go and visit Damon often in his dorm room. And I used to be a roadie for his band. I used to watch him with his college radio station. I loved just spending time with him. One day I was in his dorm room and we decided to order some Cluck U. Yes, I said Cluck U. If you think I said something else, please get your mind out of the gutter. Cluck U was a wing place that had grades of spiciness to their wings, and they had creative names for it. They had spicy, hot, nuclear, thermonuclear, global thermonuclear, all the way up to 911. For 911, you had to sign a waiver in order to eat these wings. Being the manly man that I am, I love spicy food. My mouth salivates at the chance of proving my manliness. And I knew once we ordered some Club U, this was the time to have my revenge. Once we ordered the wings, Damon didn't like spicy food. He got mild, I got global thermonuclear. His friends witnessed me taking three of my wings and burying it under his wings. And all we had to do was wait. And wait we did. So he's sitting to the side, he's eating his wings. And I'm sitting over here and I'm waiting. And I'm waiting in anticipation. And wing number one, wing number two. And I was about to leap out of my chair in excitement. Please eat the wing. And he eats the wings and he looks up. And he looks me right in the eye. And my first thought was, how the hell hot are those wings to make a blind man see? But Damon would not give me the satisfaction of reacting. He took his soda and he guzzled it to put out the flames from the fiery pits of hell that was going on in his mouth until the heat went away. And I was a little disappointed. But little did he know there were two more wings. Another mild wing, and another, and then finally the time came. He eats the wing, he looks up, looks me right in the eye. And I was like, react! React already! And he wouldn't. He would not give me the satisfaction of reacting. I knew how hot his mouth was. He would not react to what was going on. and I actually admired him. So I wondered to myself, who had revenge that day? Him or me? But I know one thing, the next day, he paid for those wings. Thank you.
One minute on the clock, please. Thank you. Our next speaker is presenting this morning project number 3 from the Interpersonal Communication Manual, which is titled Diffusing Verbal Criticism. And there are 3 parts to this. The first part will be a speech, the second a scenario, and the third an informal discussion with our partner in the project, and the audience also can participate. Alexandra has completed her competent communication manual, and she's really a zinger when it comes to the Toastmaster manual. She keeps going competent leader, and now she's working on this. So help me welcome Alexandra Belder.
You forgot our anniversary. How could you get us into this mess? You don't know what you're talking about. You don't know what you're talking about. Fellow Toastmasters, Mr. Toastmaster, I'm sure you heard these situations before. You heard these words. You have been criticized before in your life. And when we are criticized harshly, what is the first thing that we do? We become defensive, right? You feel almost obligated to prove the other person wrong because I am right. And from there, things just escalate. This morning, we are going to learn a few communication techniques that is going to help us to take an angry argument into a positive discussion. We're going to be using the responding non-defensively technique. This technique consists of 5 steps. The first one is listen. First step. There are a lot of feelings buried underneath the words that the other person is expressing to you. The second step is acknowledge. You telling the other person and you indicating that you're recognizing the criticism. The third step is ask questions. You need to understand what is more, what is behind those words. Step number 4 is paraphrase. You are going to repeat and acknowledge what the other person's feelings are by paraphrasing. And last but not least is agree with the truth. If it's a truth, why to hide it? Why say no and start a discussion? However, that doesn't mean that you agree with the other person's point of view or interpretation. Just agree with the truth. The next part of this speech this morning, I'm going to role play with Martin, and we both are going to, the situation is we both Toastmaster of this club, And he's going to bring into my attention some situations. We are going to just role play. So I need for you to please take some notes. And at the end of the exercise, please, we definitely need your feedback. I need your feedback. What went right based on these steps that I just explained, or what could have been done better? Martin.
It's like almost time for the meeting.
Yeah, Martin, I understand. I forgot to send you my introduction.
Really? I mean, you prepared, you signed up to do a speech, and I'm Toastmaster. All you had to do is email me or call me or go on the website.
Martin, I'm sensing that you're upset with me because I didn't send you the speech introduction. Is that right?
Yeah, pretty much. You know, I'm not Toastmaster every day, and it's kind of annoying not to know like what you're going to talk about. I'd like to be prepared. Everybody's usually prepared. That's why we have a great club here. Why sign up for a speech if you're not going to just do the simplest tasks of letting everybody know what you're talking about? I mean, come on.
I feel bad, Martin, and again, I'm sensing that you're very upset with me because I forgot my speech, but is anything else that I forgot before that is making you upset?
Yeah, I mean, this isn't the first time, right?
No, it's
not. So, last week you didn't even bring in the word of the day. Why sign up?
There you go. There you go.
Why sign up as a grammarian? I mean, I wish I had a zinger. Got a couple in my head, but we'll keep it PG-13 today. I mean, it's not the first time. It's not even the second time, right? Last time you signed up for the same role, you didn't prepare that speech title either. And that was the only other time I've been Toastmaster. I don't know, is it me? You got something with me? Or what?
Slept. Okay, I'm sensing, Martin, you're upset. I get that. You're upset because I didn't bring my speech intro the week before Thanksgiving. And I didn't bring the word of the day for last meeting. And obviously I forgot my speech intro to send to you yesterday. So I totally understand. I don't blame you. You're correct. What else could I do to fix this situation? You have my commitment that I won't forget this anymore. I will put a note, and you can count on the next meetings that I'm going to send you my introduction, not the day before, 3 days before. How about that?
I don't even know if I want to be like Toastmaster if you're going to sign up for a role. That's how bad.
Here.
You know, seems like everybody else is kind of just meeting the minimum requirements with somebody else's Toastmaster. So I don't know if it's got to do something with me. I hope there's not something here. I hope it's just that you've got other things going on and you're just not prepared when, you know, hopefully you should be prepared. I really hope that's all it is, because otherwise I think everybody's taking care of, you know, the minimum requirements to make this a really nice place to come every week.
Absolutely. I agree with you, Martin, and you can rest assured that it's nothing personal. I really enjoy working with you, and I'm feeling that you're taking this, like, I don't like you because you're the Toastmaster and I'm doing this on purpose, and that's not the truth. But I do recognize the fact that I forgot many, many times giving you my introduction and the word of the day. So I truly apologize for making you feel that way, which is not the truth. I'm not It's not personal. I really enjoy working with you, like I said before. So we move on from here, and you have my commitment. I will send you the word of the day and my speech intro.
I don't know, Alexander.
Come on, give me a hand. Yes.
Yes, that's it.
We were able to go through the steps. What do you think?
This is a tough cookie.
This is a tough cookie, of course.
Yeah. I kept waiting.
Yeah.
I kept waiting. I'm sorry, Gretchen.
I actually sensed some nervousness from you when he started acting the way he was acting. Yeah. Kind of caught you off guard. You were like, a little nervous there.
Yeah, totally. It's Martin, so I was afraid what to expect from him.
What's she saying?
So, yes. I thought it was good you didn't get into the excuses, you just were recognizing his anger and then gave solutions at the end of how to fix it.
Thank you for the feedback. And I'm quite honest, I work with customers, this is something, true story, real life, I work with customers, and that doing this project, I learn a lot. I have a bad temper, seriously. Called me one time. I was sending the paperwork, the contract for him to execute, and my paperwork was done in PDF, so I made some changes that he requested, send it via PDF, and he called me back and said, "How you there, send me this piece of shit."
Oh.
I was not expecting that on the phone, and I'm kind of calm with customers, and the immediate reaction was, "I'm sorry, X and Y, that you feel that my paperwork is a piece of shit." So I was paraphrasing. I was paraphrasing, literally. But he didn't took it correctly, obviously. But I just want to say this is a great project. If you're working with customers, you will learn a lot doing this project. Other than that, if you have any other suggestions or feedback, please, I would love to hear those.
Even though you were there was a little bit of nervousness in your voice, and like that you kept it pretty calm, you know, you didn't raise your voice or anything. And I know from experience that helps when you're trying to diffuse a situation.
Absolutely. Cool. Yeah,
great.
Good. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Another fact about Boxing Day, which relates to this class, it's that in the Catholic tradition, they also use Boxing Day to celebrate another day that they've given it to him that would be relevant to this club. Boxing Day is also called St. Stephen's Day. So we have a saint here, right? So the Catholic Church would refer that to Stephen in the Book of Acts, who was stone, so they just remember December the 26th. It is also a time when people go out and play sports games. I remember growing up in West Africa. That was one of the fun things I looked for, Boxing Day. Christmas Day is all with the family. The next day we are out there and we go boating and play all kinds of games we love to. The next portion of our meeting is the table topics, and our table topic master today is Laurie Richards. So if you don't have a role, please be ready for maybe a singer, whatever.
Oh, he did it. All right.
Do I have two?
since Gus let us know that Boxing Day does not have to do with boxing, but with gift giving, I would like to know what the best gift that you've ever received from an employer would be. And I think I'd like to hear from Mike Hughes.
Thank you, Jamie Thomas. That's a great question to ask because I don't recall getting any gifts from an employer per se. They say a bonus is a gift, but I see it as just back pay that they haven't quite paid yet. However, there are certain times where you become friends with your boss and they give you a gift based off of your relationship. And one time I got a gift from a boss that was a hat. And it said Special Forces on it. I was like, Well, because he was a former Army Ranger, he got me this gift for Christmas. And I was like, you know what? You're not half bad. You're not half bad. So that was a gift that was most memorable for me. So, thank you.
Cool.
All right, and we know Boxing Day does not have to do with boxing, but I want to know, would you rather watch boxing or MMA, and why?
Well, I believe when you're talking about MMA and wrestling, you're actually talking about those traditional things that we think of as MMA and more of Jane's style of wrestling. But I would have to go with my family tradition of the more theatrical type of wrestling, as I remember, WWF. So that is the drama of all of our lives played out in a small square in a huge arena. We can all get into that. You can get into the back storylines, the romances, the fights, the arguments, and then also when everybody switches sides and good becomes evil and evil becomes good.
Oh.
So I would go for the more theatrical wrestling.
Don't do it.
Thank you very much. Thank you. December 26th, Boxing Day, the day after Christmas, celebrated not only now by the British, but is really coming across different colonies, the British colonies across the world. And you know, the people actually north of our border, the Canadians, they also celebrate Boxing Day. It's sometimes referred to as a public holiday, some people call it bank holiday, and they give it all kinds of names. But can you imagine just having a couple of days off after Christmas and don't go to work? So next year, when you celebrate Christmas, just think you can have Boxing Day. Moving along and concluding my part of the meeting, we now turn on to the general evaluator, and you heard from her last week. She not only loves firefighting and being a lawyer, but also now we know that she likes boxing. So please help me welcome our general evaluator, Phyllis Herbert.
Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster. Thank you, all fellow Toastmasters and guests. Well, with our day today, we learned Boxing Day is about presents and what a present today's meeting has been. We haven't had any real harsh zingers against each other, but there have been a few spicy throws from Rich, there's been a few description of throws from James, and not to mention the verbal throws that were, that went on with Alexander's speech. So let's go ahead and start our first evaluator, Evaluating Attitude, More Important Than Facts by James Harris, Crystal Strickland. Of the speech was about attitude, and you brought in the specific purpose about fear, and you tied it in with wrestling, and you gave us a real zinger on that mat. You have such a great attitude, but when I felt you come up here, I could still feel a little bit of, of your nervousness. Breathe, speak, smile. I love the use of your voice, how you raise your voice and lower your voice, how you give pauses in between so we can all think about what you just said.
I'm just really amazed at how you have absolutely no reliance on your notes. And I felt that you did a really good job bringing in this specific purpose of the, you know, let fear stand beside you, deal with it, conquer it, you know, bring it right along with you. And so I feel that your mission was accomplished with this speech. Thank you, James. Thank you.
With our second speech, evaluation for our second speech of Revenge is a Dish Best Served Hot by Rich Massa, we have our second evaluator, Stephen Morgan.
Do I have a zinger of an evaluation for you? Madam General Evaluator for the Toastmasters. And Mr. Matt Lindman, who I'm sure is salivating all over himself every time he looks in the mirror. This is the Entertaining Speech Project, first speech out of the Entertaining Speaker Manual. He's moving on to advanced level. And this is emphasizing the structure of an entertaining speech. Often like that Organizer Speech Project from CC, number two, this is opening, body, conclusion. You had that put together very easily, very well done, because you opened with setting up the stage of how you guys love to give pranks to each other, then told us the story of the wings, and concluded with, wow, where was the real revenge? One thing I did wonder, when you opened it up, because you did open with the have I got a zinger for you, and then went into growing up in Jersey. Not too bad, but what you really did was you shoved the word of the day in at the opening, which sacrificed the real opening. That one wasn't too badly done. I have seen many which were much worse, and my general concept there is, it's 25 cents. If that's your only place to put it, pay the fine and make a much better opening. It's worth it. You did have a great plan and structure set up. I loved watching how you're watching him eating the wings. We got to watch that while you were watching you watching him put the wings together, and the way you staged that, very well done. You obviously know how to work the stage. We know you know how to work the stage. So with a bit more planning, you can do a bit more, because there are places you could put even better zingers in there. How hot could the wings be? They could make a blind man see. He's eating Jesus' flesh right there. Here is your opportunity to take it even further. Apparently he's enjoying it. But the other part of humor, and the best humor that's available, is self-deprecating humor. And you tend to step back and say, I'm going to be the manly man, and what would be even funnier for us is if we keep poking holes into that as we go through it. That would be even better, although we did get a bit of it with who was the real revenge coming from, because he wouldn't react. But some of the self-deprecation could bring in. You say he embarrassed you in front of the girl. Where was that? We wanted to see. Why would you be so incensed to want to go and take it even further? That would have been a good one to see. But you are clearly the entertainer. I keep hearing Billy Lee Joel's song going along every time you come up to the stage. That's the one you need to put a good entertaining routine to. And as James described for us, you have the attitude. You come up here and you own it, as you always do. And we can learn a lot from that. We enjoy every time you do. So next time we get the resources for entertainment, if you're going to go in order, I hope that's coming up very soon.
All right.
Very certainly, you are entertaining.
Thank you.
And for our final evaluation today, we have the evaluation of the Forgetful Toastmaster of Alexandra Balda's speech, and this is being done by Stephanie Bonnie Byrne.
Forgetful Toastmaster. Three parts to this project. The speech explaining the project, the interaction with the criticizer, and then the invitation for feedback from the audience. First of all, you had an excellent setup as to what the speech was about. You told us that there were five steps. You listed them, listening, acknowledging, ask questions to clarify, restate or paraphrase, agree with the truth, not necessarily the speaker or their viewpoint. Excellent job. Then you had your person come up, your criticizer come up, and that was good. could have told the Toastmaster, you know, exactly what you wanted for your setup so you didn't have to fumble with it. But that was okay. Then you began your interaction. And what a person you picked. Now, I know that as a business person, that she's fearless. Absolutely, she knows her craft. But with this person, there was some, because you don't know what you're gonna get from Martin.
This is true.
Life is like a box of chocolates. But you chose the non-defensive form, which is the most agreed upon, the most effective, because that way you still have your dignity intact, which you could have gotten up and walked off like I would have to defuse that. But you stayed there, you agreed with them that they were upset, and you asked questions. You restated three times. I said, "You're upset with me." And he was just singing you. He would not give up. He was very difficult to work with, and I imagine there are some Toastmasters that you will find that same type of response. So get ready, get ready, get ready. He didn't give you much to go on, but you hung in there and you said, "I'm going to this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do that." The only other thing I suggest that you could have said to him, "Tell me what I can do to restore my confidence in it." And then the onus would have been on him to suggest something that you could both agree on. And with that said, keep plugging. You can handle some difficult customers and some difficult Toastmasters as well. Thank you very much.
Our meeting so far today, and then we will go into our technical table reports. But as my first time being general evaluator, I have been for several meetings. I think everything is generally on spot, and today has been, even with me coming in just moments before the start of it. But everything was all set up. People were willing to pitch in when there were not the spots might not have been taken care of. I don't have the exact count on time. We'll get that in a few minutes, but it seemed like everybody was going on their times and it was generally very good. So we will now go to our technical table reports, and we will start with our awe counter, my cues.
James, 2 butts, 1 double clutch, great job. Rich, 5 ums, ers, you know. 1 so, 1 double clutch, Alex, 1 awe. Phyllis, you take the cake with a zinger of 10, 12 uhs. 1 so, Crystal, 2 uhs, 3 you knows, 1 double clutch, Steve, you're clean, Stephanie, I caught you know. I caught
you know?
I was looking. I was looking. Gus, you were clean, Martin, 2 uhs, and 3's you knows. That is my report. Thank you.
Just liked it because it was times 3. Ooh. Rich used it. Phyllis used it. Steven, a couple of times. Stephanie used it. Crystal used it. And you as well, Phyllis. I never am able to pick things of Grammarian, but a terrible Grammarian. So what I did like is I love the beginning from James. I cried in the blues because I had no shoes. Attitude is more important than fact. I love those different quotes. And I also liked, Rich, how hot are the wings to make a blind man see? And then, of course, your title, Forgetful Toastmaster. And that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you. And to round everything out, our timer report from Carmen Lopez.
Rich came in at 4 minutes 28 seconds.
How about short?
Alexander came out to 10 minutes 13 seconds. For our table topics, Mike came out to 36 seconds, and then Phyllis came out to 44 seconds. Evaluations, Crystal came out to 1 minute 18 seconds. Steven came out to 2 minutes 56 seconds, and Stephanie came out to 2 minutes and 47 seconds.
Oh, Julia. And back to, now we start out, or sorry, round out with our club business, and our president, Julia Kaufman.
Uplifting meeting. I love all the great speeches that were given and the lessons we learned. Anyway, the schedule for next week. We have as the toast. Oh, Martin. Toastmaster. I only recommend that anybody who has a role. I was going to have to hear it from Martin. You're a toastmaster. No. I'm the toastmaster. All right. All right, we have Tony, Mac, and Samuel that are all not here being in our speaker positions. Stephanie is our table topics master. Marty is our, everybody's not here, I have to check with him. We have Paul, Alexandra, and Kiri as
Alexandra would not be here.
Anybody want to take evaluator roles? Going once.
I'll take it.
Rich.
All right, Rich and Lori.
Oh wait, I can't next week, I'm not gonna be here.
All right, what? So we have Lori. Anybody else in case?
Who's the other one? Worry about
Paul and Kiri. Kiri will be back. Oh, I'll figure it out.
Yeah, we'll send out today.
Mike, you're listed as off counter again.
I'll take a speak role if I can do that.
Hey, sure woohoo!
I might have something to say. I'm gonna take off counter then.
Does anybody want to take off counter role? Crystal, is this your first evaluation?
Yes.
Well done. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
First evaluation.
I have to tell you, I'm so jet-lagged. Oh, you too.
That's our excuse. No, you did a great job. Phyllis as well. First time as general evaluation.
That's right.
Pretty excited about that. I thought this group was great. It was quaint, very boutique-like. Our group has about 60 people in there. It's one of the largest. And one of the world leaders is there, Ed Tate, who's been mentoring me, which has been great. So it was really good to experience something else, and I appreciate it. And it's warm here. I love it.
Church in Winter Park. So please take note, and if you want any more information about it, let us know. We can fill you in.
And Stephen's doing two presentations.
What day are you
doing? What day is that?
Which ones are you guys doing? Tell us.
What's
two I'm doing president and
leadership and or too little information.
technology, right? That's what you're doing?
No.
No?
I'm doing BPPR and then Toastmasters philosophy.
Oh, that's good. For history.
Next month or in a week is going to be New Year's resolutions.
Yeah, there we
so
go.
So if you want me to come to your business and speak about health and fitness and motivate them to stick to their resolutions, then you know, I'll be more than happy to come on in and speak to your group.
I do a lunch and learn.
Yeah, I've done a lot. And this time of year, I do a lot of lunch and learn. So if you want me to come in and speak about health and fitness, I'm more than happy to. Okay.
Professor Eat-A-Lot?
We'll bring in Professor Eat-A-Lot.
That would be hilarious. Any other business?
Julia, could you talk a little bit about not only the officers coming to the training, but all the members? Because we have potential for people to get roles to be filled in, right?
Our year runs, our fiscal year runs from July through June. So we have officers for the full year, but we're gearing up for next year. So think about what position you'd like to fill. It's a great experience, and then also you get credit for your competent leadership in taking an officer's role. If you have any questions about the roles, ask any of the officers. We'll be glad to fill you in. Make sure you bring that competent communications manual because you'll have it done quickly for bringing it in at every meeting.
Competent leader.
Come on.
Also, make sure that it's New Year's resolutions. Think about where you're. Everyone's doing great from what I see on your roles and thinking speeches and your manual. You're on fire. I see you put in for requests. So think of the next 4 months, where you're at, what award you want to get. And you can go into Easy Speak and plan it out. So if you need to get 4 speeches done by the time June rolls around, schedule it. So then you know it's ready to go. You can get it done, especially if you plan ahead of time. Anything else, Mr. BP Ed?
No, it's been a great year.
It has been a great year. My goal is to see everybody earn an award, and we're on track to do that. So if you haven't earned an award yet, your competent communication pin, your competent leadership, talk to us, let us help you get it scheduled so that you can complete that and earn it this year.
I think Macarena and Sam will be completing their competent communicator next week.
Fantastic.
And you too?
Well, if I could steal a role, maybe.
You're on a speaker.
Yes, speak.
Yeah,
just
talk
about
you have
next
like
next
two
week.
Or three more.
Yeah, one or two, something like that.
Good.
Sweet.
Good.
All right, guys. It is at the top half hour. Have a wonderful, happy new year.